When I started this journal, I wrote that if I got malaria, I hoped I'd have the presence of mind to videotape it. And now that I think I have it, I can't remember what that was all about. It seems pretty unimportant now. But I try to be a disciplined person, and what I mean by that is, when I'm sick or intoxicated or of otherwise unsound mind, I try to defer to the decisions that I made when I was lucid, when I can remember them. I wonder which mosquito was the malarial one.
Jesus, he is angry, he wants in.
But wasn't one of the points of the trip to be flexible and open to opportunities as they arose, unbound by the rigid itinerary that makes most travel miserable? The trick, of course, is to know when your original plan should be discarded in favor of a good opportunity. And when your plan only seems stupid, because you're suffering from the effects of cerebral malaria. So it turns out that I don't have malaria, and on one hand, I'm pleased that I stuck with my plan even though I was pretty sure I had malaria, and on the other, I don't know what I accomplished by videotaping the time that I didn't have malaria. So I think I could extract a lesson here about sticking stubbornly to one's plan if I didn't still feel like death. I've made lots of inquiries, but haven't had any luck finding a cargo ship going to Madagascar. And after people have been so helpful taking me around and translating, etc., I don't feel as if I can say no when they ask me to correct the English in their dissertations. I've done two so far.
What is going to happen with your girlfriend when, if you said you're late here? Hello?
Nothing. You know, I left and I told her that she should do what she needs to do.
I think she's going to suffer as much when she thinks about it.
Yeah. There's a lot of suffering. It's not good.
This story is just to remember before something's happened to me when I left my wife.
You had a wife?
I had a girlfriend.
See?
Almost to be wife.
See?
Yeah.
what
we
happened?
Separate us in the time that she was in pregnancy.
Si?
Yeah.
Por qué?
Porque ela não me precisava.
Okay.
She was loving other.
Si?
She's got a child. Yeah, but the child is belong to me.
Yes.
But that guy refused her.
Si.
Because he discovered the child doesn't belong to him.
Yes.
Yeah. So maybe. I'm still claiming about my child because he's belong to me.
That's rough. What does that have to do with my situation?
Yeah, your situation is about your wife.
Not wife.
But your wife.
No, my
your girlfriend.
See.
Yeah. What is going to happen this year?
Maybe she'll have another boyfriend.
But you are still living. So if you find her, she's married with other, what's going to happen? You don't have to suffer as much like
me. Oh, I'll suffer.
Because
like
I'm still loving her. Even I know she's married with other, but I'm still loving her.
I see.
So if one day she comes before me.
Wait a second, she's not married.
She's married.
She's not. The other man wouldn't have her because the baby is yours.
Yeah, but she think about the demanding condition which I am.
Wait a second. She's either married or she's not married.
She's married.
I hate to be a stickler, but she's either married or she's not.
she's married.
And she's not because the other man wouldn't have her because it's your baby. And I have a feeling now that you've made up the story to illustrate something about my story.
Yeah.
But it didn't really illustrate anything about my story. But thank you.
I want to advise you to return to her.
So
you are still living here.
So you made up the story. To
just go before.
Oh, well, I appreciate you making up that story for that reason. Thank you.
Yeah.
Obrigado.
Obrigado. A mim também.
So the plan now is to proceed up the coast, and if I don't find a boat in Quelimane, then surely I'll find one in Ile de Mozambique, and if not there, then Nacala, or Pemba, and so on. I've got it all totally reasoned out.
Assuming that Madagascar is this curtain, there's gotta be a boat from here to the curtain, because they're so close. Side of the Zambezi River. What exactly does that entail?
My bus didn't make it as far as I'd hoped, so I suddenly found myself without a ride.
Are you looking at the bus and not the camera? Okay.
But just as I was resigning myself to sleeping in a spare tire, some guys in a Land Cruiser appeared and, after telling me to get lost, took me with them. They're driving up the length of the country buying maize and ground nuts from local farmers, and they're actually going to Pemba, and said I'd be welcome to come along. The only condition is that I stay at the same hotels that they do so that they don't have to come find me in the mornings. $100 per night wouldn't be a shocking price for a hotel room back home, but I've been staying places that are considerably cheaper. And after growing accustomed to $10 per night, or $1 per night, or free, $100 seems devastating. I can't stop calculating how many nights of $1 accommodations that would be.
Hello, once again.
Hello.
Yeah. It would be $100.
Where are you going to?
To the first floor.
First floor.
But I actually just wanted to hear the talking elevator.
Okay.
And that there you.
I prefer what we're gonna do is let's take all the fucking stocks out, chop it up to the original plan into Malawi on transit, yeah? Get it into Zim, close down, take a little bit of a loss and knock it up there.
I usually can't follow what Vonk and Steve are talking about, and I recognize that this detour isn't exactly what I'd planned. But I think this might be the only opportunity I'll ever have to finally find out what mercantilism is.
He's got 300 tons for 16,000. It's 800
bucks. 800 tons.
Wait a moment, a moment. Divide 16,000 by
640.
300, a little bit high. Wanna have a look?
Yeah. Alright.
What is a groundnut exactly, and what is it used for?
You haven't seen?
No.
Then come here. They got all different types. If you look in the back like this, then it's mixed up of about five types.
Yeah.
I'm only interested in types like that. Yeah. But taste it.
Taste it?
In your mouth. You never eat a groundnut. Very good.
Oh.
Well, peanuts.
It's a peanut.
But here you got a groundnut.
Why?
Because the peanut is a treated product.
Uh-huh.
This is raw, so you call it a groundnut.
No, it's good.
When it's roasted, it's a peanut.
Let's take a bag with us.
Well, we're trying to buy about 15,000 bucks, so we'll see if the guy wants to give us one.
Mr. Raposo, the fox. The Mozambican fox.
Mr. Matt, he's putting you on the picture. If you're naughty, you're going to get hit.
Okay.
I want to take some samples.
Uh-huh. You'll take them with you and have them tested.
Bring them to a laboratory in South Africa.
Yeah.
And then if that is done next week, then we come back with a certified offer.
So,
give him a good start.
Yeah, 16 is a good.
This is a really naughty boy.
Mm-hmm.
Last year he fucked me around big time. And then I only supplied me half, and then the other half he said, but the price was up, now you must pay me more.
But the journey was 500 only. Only 500.
No, no, no.
500 is nothing.
Listen, what do you want to sell now? This price? Give samples?
That's what I say.
But on what price? I can do your contract for 1,000, no problem. But I'm looking at a price that also I get rich, not only you.
Yeah, but
so we each get half rich.
Yeah, we can make, but not 1,000. 200 or
150. No.
You have to come with a price that we can also make a profit.
Yes, I know, but also I have a lot of expenses.
Who's pushing the price here so high?
No, we don't push the price. We calculate the price according to our costs. We don't push.
You're saying that was a better price than you were letting on, obviously.
Well, not as good as I'd like.
Yeah.
That way.
Yeah. He's really called the Fox? Or that's just your nickname for him?
No, his name in Portuguese, Raposo, means in English Fox.
Uh-huh.
And after he fucked me around 2 years ago, since then I call him the Fox.
Vonk called that guy the Fox. But I've also heard him refer to a guy named Deke as the Fox. Then I realized he calls everyone with whom he does business the Fox.
They want a shelter.
Then I realized Vonk might be the Fox.
Hello.
Monsters up again? Hear it? Do you know the right room?
What do you mean, hear it?
My eyes must be dry. Must be no more than 30 to 40% moisture. Uh-huh. Otherwise, it doesn't store.
It goes rotten if you pack it in these big stacks.
And you can hear that?
Yeah. Easiest way to check.
Warehouses like this, all the local farmers bicycle up with their maize and sell.
Either the farmers bring it themselves, or you get small traders who've got a truck or something, they go and collect it in the bush and then bring it, sell it to others.
Buen día.
Buen día, señor. Obrigado.
Having a flexible plan leaves you open to interesting tangents and people, who in turn open a lot of doors for you. In my case, it's opening a lot of doors to grain warehouses. And now that I've become interested in grain, I realize that it's everywhere, and I hadn't noticed. It reminds me of how I lived across the street from a dry cleaner for years, but didn't realize until the first time I had to have a suit pressed. Many of the properties we visit are either owned by Vonk and Steve, or were once owned by them. And in almost all, Vonk checks on trees he planted.
Para test for that,
Farmer Vonk planted these trees.
Se você vai comprar uma coisa boa,
para tomar uma erva, ok?
Did you say Farmer Vonk?
Farmer Vonk.
See, my trees are doing well. Eh?
Ah, this is fucking beautiful. Oh, look at my trees.
Same one.
Same one.
They stay alive.
Why do you want to get it livable?
This should be a tourist place where you can hunt, see live crocodiles.
Yeah, look, someone's had lunch on the go.
It's a lake of leopard.
Keep some horses here. They like to go tourists.
Yeah, some horses.
Going walking trails to the mountains.
It's a stunning place, actually.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
Spend time.
Yeah.
On the farm, we found the original molds. Like a little place down there, like a mud wallow.
So, who do you imagine coming all the way out here?
Right now, nobody. It's a project that's kind of got started and stopped because lack of a
change of plan all over the show. So. I mean, we only bought it just for the hell of it. It wasn't like we're going to go all become farmers. And we just don't have the time.
But I thought the farm served some kind of purpose in the as far as the collection of grain.
It's just sometimes you have to acquire things. There, the future. That's what it's all about.
But at least they didn't fuck up my trees. I mean, if they'd had done that, then I would have fired everybody up here.
But what is this? This is not trees. These are fucking miserable little bushes. What are they? Like, are you breeding them as dwarf pines?
They should be big.
You can export them to Japan for
They should be big.
But didn't you put them in this small little seedling?
Yeah.
So they've grown.
Yeah, they grow.
One, they will be big.
and then I take out the pine.
You'll be fucking in a pine box by then.
I think so. I believe also.
Okay, guys, let's move.
When was the last time you guys were here?
About 8 months ago.
You just come for 10 minutes?
I haven't been here.
Once or twice a year?
No problem.
We got a fucking full program, man.
Jesus. What would you like to do? Only reason to come here.
Farm experience?
Let them know that
you could show up at any moment.
Exactly. We're still watching them. Just in case they decide to fucking do the eco-venture tours without us.
You should tell them not to write on the walls with crayon so much in the farmhouse.
But it's not priority.
We need some budding youngster that's enthusiastic and wants to
go for
his best and go for it. You know anyone like that?
I was there until you said invest.
Steve is only half serious about needing a caretaker for the farm, and obviously I've got something else that I've been trying to do. But even as I brushed it off, I knew that this would go on my growing list of offers I should have taken. Right between number 8, the time the off-the-grid family in Santa Barbara said I should live on their mountain with them and their daughter. But I left because I had to get back to school for an exam. And number 7, the time the captain of a gravel barge said he'd give me a lift all the way up the Danube. But I declined because I was anxious to know if there was a letter waiting for me care of Poste Restante in Bucharest from a woman back home. There was, and it was not worth it. But I always feel the need to stick to my original plan, even when it's arbitrary or idiotic. What a pity that my plan was not to become the caretaker of a Mozambican farm. The tragedy is that it's somebody's goal, but the opportunity that they've been waiting for all their life was offered to me. Well, the one that I've been waiting for was offered to somebody who doesn't need a ride to Madagascar.
Changed completely. I don't know why Dick told me another place. So let's hear his story first of all. If his story is a fuck up, then I will fuck him up. Send somebody else up here.
Who is Dick?
He's the manager in this area.
Yeah.
So we must talk to him.
Is he quoting you an incorrect price?
I will check.
Hi, Josh.
I fuck him off straight away, don't
we? Then
we create a situation where there's no business to be done.
No, let's first hear all the stories and then I'll see what comes out. Because I really want to know what's going on.
He tells you the wrong price because he's making a little profit for himself.
Taking a little profit for yourself is stealing. The problem is stealing so much that it makes it not really viable to buy it. So what we'll do is we'll just close down, which at the end of the day results in a lost market for the farmer, lost job for the poor fuckers that might be working for us, or him, destroy the business. I don't think about tomorrow.
Stop here.
That you guys come out here, doesn't he?
Yeah. What's your promise?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's go up there. Talk to Ali.
When we finally caught up with Deke, he seemed a little nervous.
Hey, when you fuck him up, can you do it in English?
No, in Portuguese.
Uh-huh.
I'm not gonna fuck him up because, you know, you always must be patient. There's always another part of the story.
How am I gonna know what the other part of the story is?
Apparently, Deke didn't have as much grain at his warehouse as he should have. I don't know enough Portuguese to follow all the details, but my gut tells me that he may be stashing some at his house somewhere. I wondered if Deke had the same feeling I did, that Vonk was about to whack him, sew him into a maize bag, make him sleep with the Crocs. That, of course, was what Vonk wanted him to think.
What I want to do is I chop you guys off, let me work with him, and then you can join us so that we get all the details together.
But Vonk's dirty secret is that he's a soft touch. It may serve him to pose as a grainland mobster.
If you're naughty, you're gonna get hit.
Okay.
But I think he actually does pay what he thinks are fair prices. And I've definitely seen him help smaller traders. In fact, he came to Mozambique as a bit of an idealist, volunteering as a teacher at the height of the Civil War. What's more, he supported the struggle against apartheid, repairing cars that returned from raids across the border.
Those cars came back from the raids, from the shit up.
Raids? What kind of raids?
Armed raids, hitting full time on the white farms.
For his safety and the driver's, when they took Vonk to fix the cars, he was blindfolded.
Now, of course, you could never tell those things because they would hit you.
So if ever I wanted an object lesson in diverging from one's original plan, this may be it.
I get the impression that there was an ideological component at one point that is no longer there anymore. It's been completely subsumed by just the enjoyment of business, pure business.
No, I don't think so. I've still got the same ideologics bits ahead as I was 20 years old.
But I
find another route to deal with it.
Vonk argues that the grain trade is the remedy for poverty, but I don't know. He has planted something here, but what? To be fair, they have rebuilt a system that was pulverized by the war.
This place after the war was completely bombed. We rebuilt this warehouse.
Really?
It is a pile of steel.
My only question is whether it's the best remedy, or if there's another way. One in which the spoils don't go so disproportionately to the middlemen, while the farmers and laborers who are literally doing the heavy lifting receive next to nothing. Everywhere we've gone, I've heard one trader after another say the same thing.
We don't push the price. We calculate the price according to our costs. We don't push.
And there's a pervasive willingness to take a little more from the other guy and then cry poverty. Only, as far as I can tell, none of the traders are actually living in poverty. Vonk very generously said I was welcome to stay at the beach house for as long as I wanted. But after determining that there were no boats leaving from Pemba, I figured I should continue with my plan. Not that the offer wasn't tempting, definitely about number 14 on my list. Thank you. I never thought I would be back in South Africa, but it's the risk you run when your plan is vague. Everyone said my best bet would be Richards Bay, and indeed, as soon as I arrived, I found a boat leaving for Madagascar the next day. But the two men on board had apparently just convinced two women to go with them, and for some reason they weren't amenable to my joining the crew. Having no other prospects, I accepted a ride to Durban on a catamaran from a guy named Farney. At least, I accepted the ride. I ran back to my room and checked out, got my pack and ran back, gone no more than 20 minutes, to find that he'd set sail.
I'm sure they forgot, because our Farney is the best most of the time.
Yes,
and
he
I
is.
Just got on the thing, and I just want to go, and I said, what's your fucking matter? How can you be back? I saw you walk there, it wasn't that long. You know what, he's supposed to take fucking yank with. Oh, fuck, where the hell is he? Oh, Jesus Christ, we forgot. Oh, shit, yeah.
It's just something in the back of their heads. They're thinking, we forgot. I know we forgot something. Did I leave my jacket?
Yeah, well.
Henny took pity on me and said I could sleep on board a derelict yacht called the White Diamond. It isn't going anywhere, but even making it onto a boat feels like a kind of success. Any boats leaving, so there's no practical reason to stay in Richards Bay. And yet every day I find something important to do, like sit on a boat, or draw a picture of fish, or look at fish, or chat about the same things I talk to everyone about.
I just don't know about marriage at all, you know?
This is real.
Yeah.
It's just an institution that somebody brought in.
Exactly.
People make a hell of a lot of money about it.
Exactly.
You know, so you can equally well live together and be happy. It's all a lot of bullshit.
But you got married.
Aye.
Did you get married?
Yeah. You know the old saying, when you're happily married, she's happy, you married. Especially like you're wondering. No, you can't settle yet. You're not settled. You might never say, I only got married when I was 39.
Is that right?
I'd wane when I was 40.
Is that right?
That's my first one, yeah.
Okay.
Right,
what am I looking at? I'm looking at
that's
your...
That's a skull.
Your bald head.
That's not a bald head.
Okay.
Yeah. Yet another one, yeah.
No kidding.
That's right. Now, I'm not going to show you my tool, but anyway, look at this one. Yeah.
What happened exactly?
I was 2 years old, and Dad was in a concentration camp.
What?
In Holland.
Okay.
And I'm Dutch.
No.
In the zoo.
Oh, okay.
So we went to the zoo in Amsterdam. And my eldest brother, he was standing there. I was in like a harness. My eldest brother wanted to go to the elephant, so he walked away, and my mother turned around, left me for a second, grabbed him, and I went under the barrier. And this thing said, how's it? And he grabbed me.
Yeah. What was it?
A leopard, yeah. The spotted pants leopard.
Wherever we are, the same characters reappear, like in a play or a sitcom. The yacht harbor is like an adult dormitory, and like a dormitory, I feel as if I can while away the day talking about pointless bullshit.
Why was America in Vietnam in the first place? Didn't have anything else to do.
I don't know why they're in Vietnam.
And I have no anxiety about work I should be doing. This isn't something I'm accustomed to. It's nice to know everyone and speak to everyone.
So they haven't salted your light up.
What's that?
They haven't salted your light up.
I like the candle.
You like the candle?
Yeah.
No, I'm here, man.
I guess this is what they call community, and I'm an automatic member because I'm on a boat too. Someone said the diamond has a tendency to sink, but obviously that's an exaggeration.
Jesus.
Oh. Oh, Jesus Christ. She's fucked it. Okay, what we're gonna do?
Yeah.
I want you to take your stuff off here because I'm gonna get guys that come to have a look at this.
Okay.
Stick it on Serabina in the cockpit in the meantime or whatever.
Alright.
Or at morning light, or you know, it's more spacey.
Okay.
Even if you got a bunk there, organize something with Wayne, you know, it's not a problem.
Okay.
Okay, mate.
No problem.
Sorry to chase you, but
no.
One of the guys are coming here and there's somebody in there in the bedding. Then we just, if you can fold it up and stick it in the fucking cupboards. Because I'm going to call the boss man just now to come and have a look. I said, right, here we go again. The whole fucking thing, the whole scenario again.
You can call the owner.
Well, the owner, there's 14 of them. it's absurd. It's not even funny anymore. Yeah, it's fucking absurd. I've had it right above the counter.
It looks like it. Everything's,
yeah, right above the fucking counter. It was hanging like this. And the only reason it didn't sink because I had it on half on the beach.
Yeah.
So I'm going to call the harbour master and the sheriff. And the whole fucking lot, I'm going to get them together and tell them, now, this is going to end.
Yeah.
Now, either you make a decision or I let it sink right fucking here. You decide.
Yeah, it sure is a patch. This boat sunk not too long ago, yes?
Uh-huh.
And so it was leaking through here, and that side of the catamaran sunk into the water.
Yes.
I'm expecting a pop at any stage and then you go middle and down. So keep your stuff on the highest level.
Well, maybe I should go to bed with a snorkel on it. Well, somebody needs to dive and find the hole, right?
No, I just put it on the beach.
Are you going to put it on the beach? Well, that kind of ruins my plan of diving and finding the hole.
There's a snorkel hanging there. You want to use it?
Yeah, but I want to dive with a reason. I want to look for the hole.
I need to see a hole underneath there. I'll tell you now.
Yeah.
That thing is held together by barnacles. If one barnacle falls in love with one on the other side, he fucks off and that thing sinks. It's as simple as that. You know, or he immigrates or something. And that's it.
If I didn't know what I was doing, nobody would want to come and sail with me.
Yeah.
If my boat wasn't up to scratch, nobody would want to sail with me. And those are the people that you'll probably end up with, you see. So you've got to be so careful, because it can be a treacherous coast, and you're on a boat that's, or a skipper that doesn't know what he's doing, it can be terrible. And some people have personality changes out there. Am I saying anything that you're not agreeing with?
Is that right? What do you mean by that? Personality changes?
It's not the same person that you've been chatting up on shore and you get to know. They become totally different. And it can be scary. Really scary. I don't know if it's why they change. I'm not a psychologist. Whether it's fear or insecure or what. But they can really change and make life miserable for you.
Do you change?
No. But I can see that you can change if you're insecure.
Hmm.
If you're scared.
Mm-hmm.
Have you been sailing? Have you done a passage?
Not overnight, no.
You haven't done an overnight sail yet?
No.
He gives a shit, man. He's adventurous. It doesn't matter.
You think that's all that matters?
Yeah.
Yeah, no, you gotta be adventurous.
You're gonna be adventurous. Oh, you haven't done an overnight one yet. Okay.
There are fatalities crossing the Mozambique Channel.
The guy whose keel fell off. Well, yeah. No, they weren't killed.
Well, he was coming from Mauritius, and, you know, keel broke off.
But they were rescued.
No, all lost. Huh? When you're out there, you're on your own. No, you can have fancy things. There's nobody that's going to come and help you.
The guy never stayed in one place for too long. So the boat stayed in one place for like one day, or 2 days, and 3 days. And someone went to go greet him, like visit him or whatever. And he was lying in the cockpit with his head chopped off, like it's like freaking totally
decapitated. Yeah, I believe so.
It's like his head was lying over there.
Yeah.
There's nobody just under the horizon. And often by the time they say, oh no, he's really overdue, it's far too late. Far too late. That's why experienced sailors, they make sure everything's really right. And they keep working on their boats and check the rigging and do this and do that. And
we just hope that the sealant arrives in Africa.
Oh, really? Are you waiting for something?
Yes. The entire country of South Africa is out of white Sikaflex.
Every time you work away on your boat, like, there's a little box somewhere on the boat. A little point's going to it. You can't see the box. A little point's going to a box, you see? And one day, when you're in a big storm, you're really in trouble and so on, you start losing points out of that box. And if the storm's over and there's still points in the box, you're okay. But if that box runs empty, you're
bare right.
So that's why we're always piling points into that box.
That's yes. right, because it's usually yeah. a sequence of bad events
that's right.
that it's does you in.
It's not one tragic thing. It's no. just not, like it's some little thing and then some
other thing. Another little thing and another, you know.
Wait, does that mean that someone could come on?
About 4 o'clock, 1550, I say 1600. Mm-hmm. It's quite a high tide.
You can throw me that line, I'd appreciate it.
Now that the diamond has been beached, I sometimes emerge in the morning to find it surrounded by water. Or alternately, surrounded by muck.
He's been taking barnacles off there, and you know, I'm worried if he does that, then we might go right through.
There's a holding factor there. The wood is just as a base. 2 years, darling.
2 years.
I'm going to keep a little patch, eh?
How long are you going to keep it here?
So we're going to open it up, take the patch off.
Yeah.
And we'll put a bigger patch on, and we'll do the
but
whole
why,
thing.
But why don't you just leave them?
But remember, there's a bit of a security risk, guys, because many people can get on here easier.
Yeah,
you see, this is one of the problems. Yeah, that is the thing.
I've
got Matty sleeping in here at the moment, just to look after
him. Oh, are you looking after
him? Yeah, he's sleeping on board, so at least there's somebody here.
Yeah.
You see, because otherwise he can get in and steal the place rotten car.
Now listen, you must get your stuff off the boat. The lawyer is coming there now.
Oh, really?
I don't want them to know fuck all.
Yeah, but wait a second. The sheriff just told me that I'm instructed to stay on the
boat. Yeah, I know. That's fine. But now the lawyer's coming, so you get your stuff off so long.
Do you see the boat? That is not easy to get my stuff on and off this boat.
We're getting the stickies here. We're getting a ladder.
We're putting oh, you are.
A boarding ladder.
Oh, nice.
Now we're organizing.
Story which I would love to
hit
the
yeah,
final
yeah.
chapter.
You think you're the only one? How do you think I'm going to feel to get up in the morning and I need a mouse stick, son? Then everybody will come down to any Look, this can be done, but yes, it's a decent job. Because that whole bottom part, all that wood's going to come off. If the ribs are still alright. And they can dry them out. They have to dry it for months and months and months, and then I'm going to put penetrating grease on. But she's suffering, eh?
This is the closest you'll find me on this yacht.
So guys, this basically is the sad story of White Diamond.
I thought about sticking around just to find out what would happen to the diamond, and I guess that's how the plans we make are subverted, aren't they?
And I will leave somebody on board.
It's not one thing that does you in.
Like some little thing, and then...
Another little thing.
First, you become interested in grain, and then you're living on a sinking yacht, and before you know it, you're off your plan while still believing you're pursuing it.
It's okay. What's going on?
We're gonna do a quickie.
What's that?
Very South African thing.
Okay.
And then Nell's gonna do the samp and beans.
No.
All right. It's all South African.
Great. What should I do?
Bring your ukulele and a good appetite.
But it is tempting to stay. I don't often feel as if I'm part of a community. One where, when Al's daughter is getting married, Isaac performs the ceremony. Henny and MJ handle the guests. Henny's wife is the planner. Maureen throws the bridal shower. Wayne is the DJ. And the ceremony is held in view of the White Diamond. And because I'm the videographer and gave the bride and groom my tape as a wedding present, it's almost the only event on my whole trip for which I don't have any footage. But one has to stick to one's plan. And so I continued preparing for my voyage. But automatically, and without disappointment when no boat appeared.
Now we are leaving to Durban.
Now we are going.
And when Kamari and her daughter went to Durban one day, I tagged along and posted my usual note at the Durban Yacht Harbor, little expecting that I would hear immediately about a boat leaving for Madagascar.
Bernard?
And just like that,
hi, it's Matt.
Be enlisted as the crew.
How are you?
But what about all the people you leave behind? Should you be so wedded to your plan that you allow it to carry you past some place you ought to have stayed? When I look back at places I've been, what I think most often is, I should have lingered. Some relationships are like maize, and they don't store indefinitely. After the wedding, I got a shot of the sinking diamond from the wedding tent, imagining at the time that it would be a sort of acerbic metaphor for marriage. But I'm just not as certain about that as I was. A lot of things I thought were bad don't look as bad to me anymore. And now I think it might be a different sort of metaphor. And the metaphor might be on me. There is a little box, and points go in the box. You can't see the box. And when there's a big storm, you start losing points out of that box. And when the storm's over, and you still have points in the box, you're okay. But if that box runs empty,
you get parts of Madagascar where the people are so habitable.
Territorial. Uh-huh. Very territorial.
And if you actually go into the territory, but you'll never go there. It's like,
what do you mean? That's the kind of places I was...
No, but they kill you if you go into their territory. No, I'm serious. You won't really find the place.
But
it's shit
that we haven't got ahead. Very difficult.
Not gonna work.